So hello, my name is Ritesh. I'm a lead software developer at Anarock. And I'll be talking about web workers. Initially, the subtitle was a graphical intro. But now, yesterday when I was rearranging my slides, I realized that there's more music than graphics. So I actually changed it to a musical intro. So first of all, I will talk about how JS actually works. Then I'll take up a demo and explain how I improved the performance of that app. So this is a tiny code snippet, okay? And it's, I think everyone from front-end developer and back-end developer can understand this. So it's not working. Good. So this is a small video. I paste that code snippet on my console. Try to click on the REPL, and you can see that my clicks aren't getting triggered. So basically, it's not getting registered. And as soon as that function completes, then your clicks are getting registered. So this is happening because your main thread is actually blocked. So traditionally, web browsers only have a single thread. So we say that JavaScript is single-threaded. And sometimes we also say that the browser is single-threaded. But saying JavaScript is single-threaded is correct. Browser is single-threaded is not correct. Okay, so browser assigns a single thread to each of your tabs to run your JavaScript on. So that's a single thread. So I'll explain how it is. So imagine this line is the main thread, and the small dots that you can see is the code that you actually write. So the yellow ones are the blocking code, and the red ones are the non-blocking code. But if JS is single-threaded, all the code should be blocking, right? So where does that red code come from which doesn't block the thread? So to understand that, first we have to understand that the code we write actually consists of two parts. It's the web APIs and core JavaScript. So core JavaScript is blocking. Okay, and there are some web APIs that are non-blocking. Most of them are blocking, but there are few which are non-blocking. How does this happen? So you can see that on the left, I've written few web APIs that we generally use. And on the right, you have the core JavaScript. So if you have learned, if you have started learning JavaScript or any language, the first thing that you generally do is you do a where A, where B, add them, and you do some operations, and then you feel that, okay, you know the language, because tutorial just tells you about that. Then you start thinking that, okay, this is JavaScript, fine, but how do I interact with the DOM? I mean, it's not just addition, subtraction, division, and all. So the browser gives you a set of APIs to interact with the DOM. So those are web APIs. Those are not part of core JavaScript. Okay, so now, so since browser has given you few of their APIs, they can handle them. Okay, so they can say that, okay, these are the set of APIs that I have given you. And few of them, I can keep in my own thread. Okay, so things like timers, set intervals, set timeout, these go on a separate thread, on the browser's thread, stay there until their time comes to get executed. Okay, so that was the concept about how few APIs like set timeout, promises, and all move to a separate thread. They still get executed on the main thread itself. Okay, it's like they are waiting on a separate thread, not blocking the other code. And when their time comes or your call stack is empty, they come back and get executed in the main thread. So this is just event loop in a nutshell. Okay, so before introducing you to my app, I had to make this clear how basically JavaScript works, how multi-threading actually works in JavaScript. So I have learned music, I mean, for around 5 years or more. And there are times that I went to learn music to some classes or something. And then I realized there was a very big problem in how they teach music. Okay, so because they always start from scratch. Now, how many of you here are, I mean, some point of time in their life tried to learn something? I mean, learn something in music, an instrument. Maybe you would have given up after some time, but you would have tried to learn something, right? And how many of you had given up after some time? Why do I see more hands in giving up than tried? So, there are multiple reasons. We are developers, basically lazy, okay? And we don't have time, okay? To take out some time, go to a class and learn music, that's hard. And also it's expensive, okay? It is expensive, they charge you by hours. And the most irritating thing is, you go there, you mostly, when you go, you have a song in mind that you want to play. You want to learn that song, and they start teaching you from scratch. Okay, so imagine someone says that, okay, I will teach you Sa Re Ga Ma Pa, and after 1 year, you will be able to play this song that you want. You give up, okay? So, so I had an idea that what if I make it accessible for everyone? So you can just open your browser, play the app, learn music, connect your piano, and it's in your control what you want to learn, what you don't. Okay. So I'll show you a demo. So this is the app. Okay. It's still a work in progress. This is just an initial, you can say that, initial thought that I had about the app. So first I select the file. Then I select the track. Okay, sorry. The sound isn't playing. So, there are three parts to this app. Okay, the first thing, talk about them one by one. So first I loaded a MIDI file. Any MIDI file you find on online, you can just load it. Then I played the music, you heard the sound, and then you saw some visualization on the top, right? So when I thought about this, I realized that there will be a lot of challenges because you're playing audio on a browser and every day you come across things like your main thread is getting blocked. Imagine you're a single tune getting delayed just because your main thread was blocked. The whole music app doesn't make sense. Okay, so so let's go one by one. So loading MIDI files. So this is the normal code that you will write to load a simple MIDI file. Okay, you'll load the MIDI file, you'll parse that MIDI file, and then you'll get a JSON or a object which your JavaScript can understand, and based on that you'll play the music. Okay, so the biggest problem here is your MIDI file can be very large. And why it can be large, for to make sure you understand that, I will have to tell you what a MIDI file has. Okay, so MIDI file has an info to all the tracks in a particular song. So the different tracks are the different instruments that are getting played. And then it has the info about which note was played at which time. Okay, and for how long. So you have to first parse that, and that's a heavy computation if your song is very big. Okay, and the problem is you're blocking your main thread. If you're using, if you're parsing the file in your main thread, it's getting blocked. So the file loading part is still asynchronous. It's a web API. It goes in a separate thread, waits. But the parsing part is still synchronous. Okay, it's still blocking your main thread. So the solution. The solution will be if we are able to move that blocking JavaScript code that we talked earlier into a separate thread. Okay, so we are already able to move those non-blocking web APIs separate. So how do we achieve concurrency for the yellow ones, which are by default synchronous? So even when they are synchronous, you create a different thread and you move it, but you still don't say that JavaScript is multi-threaded. Okay, because it's the browser, it's the environment that is providing you a separate thread. It's not done by JavaScript by default. Okay, so you can use a hack, like you can wrap your whole function inside set timeout, and then it will go into a separate thread. But if you're aware, the time that you give in the set timeout is not the actual time that callback will get executed. It's the minimum time that the callback will get executed. Okay, so that's still hacky and won't solve your problem. So the solution is web workers. So what are web workers? Generally, they're a separate thread provided by the browser where you can run your code. Simple. Okay, so there's a worker thread, and you can now move your code to that worker thread. But there are a few limitations. You can't access your DOM from there. Okay, and the messaging happens through the post message API. You can't just send data from A to B and B to A. So, and we can create multiple web workers. This is a question that comes, how many web workers are enough? It depends on your OS actually, because it is using your OS to spawn a new web worker. Okay, so, and you can also spawn a sub worker from a worker. If you think that a single worker is doing a lot, in itself it can be blocking, right? I mean, a single worker can become slow if it is doing a lot of things inside itself only. But the use case is very less that you want to create a separate web worker from a web worker. So let's see how we use a web worker. So there's a worker constructor available in the browser. Workers are pretty old in concept, so majority of browsers support that. You actually create a new instance by passing the URL of your worker file, and then you can send your message via the post message API to your worker from your main thread. Then the worker actually accepts that message. It's a kind of an observer pattern, not exactly, but similar to that. You get that data, you do whatever you want to do with that data, and then you send back the result via the post message API. Okay, and then your main thread gets back that message. This is web worker in a nutshell, very easy to implement. So let's get back to the problems that we were trying to solve. First one was loading files. And now the file upload part has been moved to the web worker. Okay, so it gets the message, it gets the URL to that file, it reads that URL, gets the data and parses it, sends back the parsed JSON object to the main thread. Okay, so we have handled that problem. So our second problem is playing music. Okay, so playing music involves two parts. First, you have the info about at what time a particular note should start and for how long it should play. But you have to still create callbacks for that, so that you play a particular note at a particular time, right? So so first you schedule that notes, schedule the playing of those notes, and then you play the actual sound. So the second part is handled by the web audio API. So by default, web the audio plays in a separate thread. So you don't have to worry about that. But you still have to worry about the first part, scheduling notes, because it has a lot of, I mean, still has a lot of problems. So everyone here would have used date.now, right? You know how the JS clock works. So the minimum precision there is of 1 millisecond. And if you're making a music app, the precision is far less than that. You require a precision far less than that. Okay, so that's the first challenge. And the second challenge is, how do you create callbacks? How do you call a particular function and ensure that it's getting called at the right time? Because if your main thread is blocked, it will get delayed. And even if a single note gets delayed, your whole song is going to be terrible. So, there are two solutions, I mean, for each one of them. So first, the first one is that you use a combination of set timeout and audio hardware clock. So there's also a spec right now, high precision time spec. What it does is it gives you time. The precision is very less than in milliseconds. Okay, so has anyone heard about performance.now? There's an API called performance.now. So that uses that spec. Okay, and but still it's not available in all the browsers. And so as a fallback, what you can do is you can use the time that is given to you by the web audio context. So when you want to play a sound, you have to first create an instance of the web audio API, create a new instance of the audio context, and you have to pass it to that. Now, it's fine even if you don't understand all this, but one thing that you can understand is, using the web audio API, you can get the actual OS time. And OS time is far better than the JS clock time. So by using the combination of set timeout and that, you can achieve that precision. But coming to the second problem, the JS timers. I mean, first problem is a problem, but not as bad as the second one. So for that, you have to move your timers into a worker and ensure that you are not doing anything else in that particular worker that can delay or block the worker thread. Okay, so by doing these two, you have actually made sure that the scheduling nodes part is also happening at the right time. Okay, so we have tackled two problems. Now, the third and the biggest problem is the visualization. So the top part that you see in the demo is what I'm referring to as the visualization. Now, the first solution to this is you create multiple divs and then move it from top to bottom, right? And keep it in sync with your audio. But the problem is that every time you try to re-render, you are doing painting, re-layouting, composition, and everything. You are blocking the thread, okay? And it will make your app slow. You will lose the sync between your audio because you have already handled audios, but you also have to make sure that your visualization is in sync. So if you are doing this by divs, you are going to, see a lag. So the solution to this was canvas. The top part is a canvas. Okay, and one more thing. So I had already made a timer scheduler for playing the sound. So do I actually need to create a new callback for the visualization? Can't I use the same timer to actually also keep that visualization in sync? The problem is, when you hear music, you want to hear it at the correct time. But when you are rendering something, you want to achieve 60 FPS. You don't always want to update your rendering just because your sound has changed. Okay, so there's a difference in time. I mean, you don't want to do changes to the visualization at the same time that you have done the played the sound. Okay, so that problem can be solved by a single timer also if you are using request animation frame. So if you are using request animation frame, you can create a single callback and then keep the visualization timer also there, and also the audio playing code there. So why Canvas? How did it solve my problem? So Canvas is scriptable. What does this mean? Imagine you have a TV on your wall, okay? You have set your TV. It has already taken its space. The content that you see on the TV is controlled by somewhere else, okay? So you don't have to worry. You can put the different frames that you want to put on the wall because you are sure that the size of the TV is not going to change, okay? Only the content is going to change. Now, in case of Canvas, if you want to even change the size, you have to use JavaScript for that. Okay, and when you are just changing the content, you are not, changing the boundaries and anything. So you can actually show whatever you want in the canvas by using JavaScript. So what does this mean? That if I want to change the content of canvas, I don't actually need the DOM once it is already present in the DOM, right? And so what I can do is, I can move the control of my canvas to a worker because it doesn't need the access to the DOM. Okay, so this is a main thread. I use a new API called transfer control to off screen, and then I push the off screen to a worker. Fine. So what's this? So to understand this, you have to understand the post message API. So by default, what you can transfer through the post message API is a serializable content. It has to be an object or anything that's serializable. So first you serialize it, then you use post message to send it, then there you deserialize it. And this whole process is actually you're copying your object, and this process is slow. Okay. So the solution to that is transferable objects. So transferable objects like array buffers, something, if you're coming from a CCPP background, you have heard about pass by reference, or also in case of objects. So what you're doing here is you're not creating a copy, but you're actually transferring the reference to that object. But the con here is that it's no more accessible in one thread, and it has been totally passed to another thread. So the alternative to this is shared array buffers. So it is being shared by both the threads. The reference is being shared by both the threads. But the problem is that if A makes changes to it, and then B also makes changes to it, there can be a race condition. And this problem is solved by using atomics, something that I'm not going to talk about here. So the second argument that you see in the post message API is the transferable list. You have to pass the transferable that that you actually want to transfer. The first one is the data, the second one is the transferable list. So this is the time difference. You can see that transferable objects are pretty fast compared to serialization. And so now what I have done there is the main thread has transferred the transferable to the worker, and it has no control over it. Now in the worker thread, you actually get the canvas, okay? And you can do whatever you want to do the canvas, what you would have done on the main thread. It's just a normal canvas. You can do all the operations that you were able to do on the main thread. So this is the main ways I have actually used web worker on my app. So mostly my main thread is still empty. The things that I want to do in future is I want to show the OpenSheet music. It's like you'd have seen that there's some and everything written on a paper. The musicians see that and play the song. So that is OpenSheet music, and I can render it in a canvas using the same transfer to off-screen API. But the problem is it's not supported everywhere. It's a very new API, and I'm still figuring out how to solve that problem. Maybe I might not be able to show the visualizer in every browser, and I don't want to show it with a lag. If I move the canvas to the main thread, then the problem will be as soon as I add some other feature that might create or lock the main thread, my visualizer will come out of sync. I don't want to do that. So I'm still trying to figure that out. So this was the demo. What more it can do? So you saw the read part. It was the read mode where you upload a file, you read the file, and then you see it. Okay. This is the write part where you can actually play, and then you can actually see what you're playing, and you can do multiple things here. You can play using 128 sounds. It's a MIDI spec. There are only 128 sounds. You can record what you are playing. You can download the MIDI file, and you can actually connect your any MIDI device, maybe a keyboard or a piano, and control it from there. And you can do the vice versa. Okay. So this is a demo where the keyboard is being controlled by the browser. Okay, so the sound is coming from the keyboard. The MIDI file has been uploaded on the browser. Okay, so this was about the talk. Thank you. Any questions?
Hi.
Hi.
So, is there any solution to the problem if your web worker is overloaded? And there can be scenarios where your web worker is loaded.
Yeah. So, you can spawn a sub worker from a particular web worker. Okay. So, what does that mean? That you are creating a separate worker from that worker to handle that process. The way you are offloading tasks from your main thread, you can offload tasks from your worker also by creating a new worker from that worker. Understood? There can be hierarchy, there can be multiple workers, and there can be multiple workers in, under a single worker, and the whole hierarchy can go on.
Is there any limit to that?
Like there's no limit.
But it takes the memory, that's it.
There's no number. It depends on the browser and the OS that you are using.
And what about the security when you share the data?
Sir, follow-up questions you can take offline. He'll be available.
Hi. Do multiple workers create multiple threads or they lie in the same thread?
No, multiple. So for example, if you are, stopping your code at a debugger, others won't be affected, they will keep running.
Hi.
Yeah, hi.
Yeah, so my question is about the scheduling of nodes that you did. You told that there is a performance.now that gives a better accuracy of time, right?
Yeah.
But then set timeout still takes it in milliseconds, right?
So what I didn't went into is there is a concept called look ahead timing. Okay. So you don't put the timers for the whole song at once, but you create chunks of that song. Okay. And then you set timeout for that chunk only. Okay, so the solution is that even if there's a problem with one set timeout, other won't be affected. Okay, so you are just decreasing the possibility of going out of sync. You're not actually totally solving the problem.
All right, thank you. Any more questions? No, all right, thanks.